Thank you, Winnell, for the lovely prelude. That was an awful lot of fun. It's always nice to have you in the house. If you haven't met Winnell, tap her on the shoulder or give her a big smile after worship. She is such a blessing to us all in our worship space. And Megan is back in the tech booth. Hi, Megan. She's working her wonders today. We have a little video that I think you might enjoy, and I think she got it up, did you? Yay, good deal. And thank you, readers, for welcoming people today. And we have a special table out in front of the church, and it was the United Methodist Women, and they are preparing for their salad luncheon. And what's the date on that salad luncheon?
May 5th.
From when to when?
11 to 1.
So if you're watching online, May 5th from 11 to 1 in our fellowship hall here on 10th and 10th in Safford. And we have a wonderful group of people, so you can get to meet some of us and make some friends. How was your week?
Good.
Were you busy running here and there? No. Did you just have some quiet time at home that you can sit and relax? I think I had about 2.5 minutes for that. It was a good week because, like Philip says, when I'm busy, it usually keeps me out of trouble. I haven't found that to be true. I think the more things I'm involved in, the more trouble I get in. I'd like you to take just a moment to center your hearts for worship and to look around you at your friends and your neighbors here in the house of worship. So, good to see you. Good to see you, friends. Now, I just want you to know that us being so close and such good friends, you're welcome to stick around after worship and visit a little bit. I know a lot of you like to jump in your car and go have breakfast. But sometimes it is nice after worship to just talk to people who experienced the same thing you did, the presence of the Lord, and just kind of get together and enjoy that moment. Our opening hymn today is Morning Has Broken, one of my favorite hymns.
Morning has broken, I feel so lonely.
a street corner. Do you remember the flower children of the late 60s and 70s on the street corners selling flowers? One of them had a little transistor radio of some sort and was playing that song. And I did not know the meaning of that song until probably 30 years later. I did not know that that song had spiritual meaning and goodness in it, but praise the Lord, it was lovely to sing that with you today. Let's pause for a moment and center our hearts on worship. Holy God, allow me to be quiet in my mind for just a moment and prepare myself for worship. Help me to realize that the noise within my own soul can block out the message that you would have for me this day. Holy God, allow me to clear my mind of the noise and the clutter of the world and feel your holy presence within me. Let me be a part of this worshiping community of faith in you. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
A call to worship. God is here.
We meet to offer our prayers and praise.
Here are symbols of our faith, the altar, the light, and the cross.
They remind us of our lifelong need of grace.
Here, children from 1 to 100 find a welcome into the fold.
Where together we learn to become more like Christ.
In this age of doubt and fear, keep us faithful to the gospel.
We cannot have abundant life without you, as every morning is new.
I have a special object lesson today that I think that you will really enjoy. It's a music medley. And the numbers are the year and the song.
Blind, but now I see.
darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light.
Thank you.
times throughout the years. This gentleman is David Wesley, and he is from a long line of faithful people. And I would love to see him in person, wouldn't you? Boy, his personality is, well, all four of him, right? How many of them were there?
Six.
Yeah, that was really something. So thank you for letting me share that with you today.
Boy, I wanted to get up and...
soon, very soon.
Okay, our Bible reading today comes from John 20, 19 through 30. Later on that day, the disciples had gathered together, but fearful of Jews had locked all the doors in the house. Jesus entered, stood among them, and said, "Peace to you." Then he showed them his hands and sighed. The disciples, seeing the master with their own eyes, were awestruck. Jesus repeated his greeting, "Peace to you. Just as the Father sent me, I send you." Then he took a deep breath and breathed into them. "Receive the Holy Spirit," he said. "If you forgive someone's sins, they're gone for good. If you don't forgive sins, what are you going to do with them?" But Thomas, sometimes called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, "We saw the Master." But he said, "Unless I see the nail holes in the hands, put my finger in the nail holes, and stick my hand in his side, I will not believe." 8 days later, his disciples were again in the room. This time, Thomas was with them. Jesus came through the locked doors, stood among them, and said, "Peace to you." Then he focused his attention on Thomas. "Take your finger and examine my hands. Take your hand and stick it in my side. Don't be unbelieving. Believe." Thomas said, "My master, my God." Jesus said, "So you believe because you've seen with your own eyes. Even better blessings are in store for those who believe without seeing." Jesus provided far more God-revealing signs than are written down in this book. So you will believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and the act of believing have real and eternal life in the way he personally revealed it. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Don't you wish you would have been there? Sometimes I do. And other times I think, yeah, I probably wouldn't have been ready for that. I would have been Thomas over there. What a blessing that God just brings us along inch by inch in our own personal lives and as a church, growing in faith together. So I wonder, have you ever been so scared, so frightened, that you couldn't wait to get home? And once you were there, you closed the door and you locked it. And then he went around and checked all the windows and the back door and the sliding glass door, too. Maybe you even looked in the closets and under the bed. Fear is real. Can you imagine the fear of the disciples The fear that they were all experiencing together when Jesus was killed. Remember that when you strike the master, they scatter. I'm sure there were many people during that time who were living a bit scared at that point in history, and they did scatter, and they hid wherever they could. They had heard Jesus preach and sat and listened as he talked about God's creation and beloved created. They watched in awe as Jesus brought life back to a boy. Kings, the temple priests, the Romans, and it seems many of the very people who followed Jesus and saw his power and felt his love fell into Satan's trap and were so frightened. All they wanted to do was for Jesus to go away permanently. They were afraid. Their lives were in danger. Jesus had been captured, crucified, and buried. 11 of the disciples were in hiding, trying to retell the whole story as a group, trying to figure out what happened and when and what led up to this horror. All of them were adding what they remembered and piecing it together. You've done that before, right? Maybe at a family reunion where someone starts to tell a story and you say, oh, wait a minute, I don't remember like that. And you all start pitching in and the story becomes real again. Well, Thomas, in this part of the story, was what I like to consider a day late and a dollar short. To Thomas, seeing was of the utmost importance because seeing is believing. So since he did not see Jesus, he could not wrap his head around Jesus being alive. I'd like to say that if I would have been there, I would have been one to say, oh yes, Jesus is alive. But truth be known, I might have a little Thomas in me, that kind of prove it type of thing. And I think that's really what kept me away from the church for so long. I couldn't see it. I couldn't touch it. I couldn't feel it. I just didn't understand. I think many times in our lives, we are all a little more like Thomas than we'd like to admit. I'm sure all of us at one point in time have had a difficult time believing something that didn't follow the laws of nature, right? Show me. Let me touch it. Let me see it for myself. Let me experience this. I don't know about you, but I've heard many times in my life, and truth be known, I've probably said it several times, if I hadn't seen it for myself, I would have never believed. But when we say I see, it doesn't mean that we see just with our eyes, does it? Oh, I see. I see means I understand. Oh, I see. I get it. I know. I feel it. I see. We see means we believe it to be true in our mind and in our heart and in the very depths of our being. The disciples were blessed to see the master's power with their own eyes. And they had been awestruck wherever they went. Can you imagine the first time Jesus healed someone? The time that Jesus healed someone just by speaking the words and the person was miles away. Just imagine the feeling it is when a miracle happens right before your eyes. They had seen Jesus raise Lazarus after 3 days of him being dead and in the tomb. Now, I don't know about you all, but if I would have been there, I would have been, oh, no, I'm out of here. You're not opening that tomb. 3 days of decarnation. The smell had, I would think it's going to be terrible. Well, why are we doing this? But they rolled that stone away. They heard a rustle in there. And all of a sudden, maybe a yawn and a stretch and a, where am I? And out comes Thomas, very much alive. I find it interesting that people, though Jesus had told them he would be raised from the dead, they didn't expect it. I don't suppose we would expect it either. Maybe we're thinking, he's thinking figuratively, not in a way that it really happened, but Jesus raised people from the dead, and God raised Jesus from the dead. They were not expecting God to raise Jesus from the dead. They weren't. A lot of them went home and hid. And yet, Jesus raised from the dead, and his greeting was, "Peace be with you." So how do we, as Christian faithful, how do we prove? Do we have to prove this to people? How do we prove this to people in a way that they wouldn't feel threatened or talked down to or pushed aside? How do we prove that Jesus is risen? Risen from the dead, and even after a couple thousand years plus, Jesus is still here. Though he arose, he came to live among us mere humans, to lead us and guide us every step of our way. I wish I knew how that worked, but I can't tell you. I can't tell you how Jesus is in each and every one of us this morning, right now, and in every church and synagogue in the entire world. Jesus is alive and well. You may not know this, but in Judaism, during the time of Jesus, the idea of resurrection was not a foreign concept. It's biblical. The first emerges clearly in the 2nd century BC in the Old Testament book of Daniel. It begins as a belief in the resurrection of the soul alone. Not like Jesus, body and soul, but the soul alone. Resurrection is real. The resurrection that we experience is personal. It's a relationship with God, and it's like Jesus coming and just waking us up for the next day, for the new day. It's something that we all might wrestle with, Maybe you're still wrestling with it a little bit, ingesting it, thinking about it. It takes time for us, and God knows that. God gives us time on this earth, and hopefully, little by little, we're seeing those aha moments and the presence of God through Jesus Christ every walk of our journey. It is a choice that we make to be on this walk together. God, not only in our lives, but in all the people who have gathered today, all around the world, in praise of Christ. It is a choice for us to believe that God loves us, even when we're not, even when we're throwing a fit, even when we're stomping our feet and just grinding our teeth and so angry. God created us with those emotions, didn't he? You're not going to surprise God by stomping around and being upset. But I don't know if you're like me, and I do have those moments. Lord Almighty, I have those moments. After all that energy of anger and frustration and sorrow spills out, I'm exhausted. And then comes the presence that I can feel of Jesus. You know, Jesus was angry many times in his life. And the one that always comes to mind is, would he stomp in here and throw our tables, throw our offering plates like frisbees, clear the communion table? What would Jesus do if he came in to be with us? Would that be who Jesus is? Or would Jesus come and just put a hand on our shoulder, look into our eyes, and smile? That's my Jesus. That's the way I want to see Jesus in my heart and in my mind and in my soul. But I do know that when I've overstepped my bounds, when I've misspoken and hurt people, that Jesus gets a little cross with me in my own mind. And I can hear loud and clear that I have some work to do. Work to do of apologies, and work to do in my inner self, that I would not allow that to happen again. Jesus said, just as the Father sent me, I send you. Where do you think God will send you this week? Where do you think Jesus wants you to go? What kinds of things have you been putting off that you know you should do? Maybe calling someone or helping someone with something or mending fences. Let this week be that week that you take a look at what's happening in your life and happening in the lives of people around you. You know, Philip and I kind of live on an island. Where am I? There. We don't have neighbors. And so for us to connect with our neighbors, we have to make a decision to do it. Make the decision. Practice what you're going to say. Maybe take something with you, like the Lord's Prayer or a psalm that would help you open conversations. conversation and be the hands and the feet and the voice of our risen Christ. Amen. Let's join our voices together in hymn number 3179. It's in the little green book, and it is called The Risen Christ. Sitting at the feet of Jesus. old body. All these wrinkles, these tired eyes will be made new again through Jesus Christ. Our communion is many times called a feast. Now, when I was a new Christian, I really thought that was a misnomer. This is a feast. This is the feast of victory for our Lord. This tiny piece of bread or wafer and this grape juice. How can that be? How can it be that I should gain the Master's love and push aside pain? But it works, doesn't it? It works because God joins us, not just in this building, here and here, and as a collective group of people of faith. Now, last week we had communion, and if you were here, it was delicious wheat bread and that sweet touch of wine, new wine, or Welch's grape juice. This week, it's a little different. Because the bread has changed. We left it out, and it has gotten old, and it has gotten crunchy. Sounds like my knees in the morning. The thing about Jesus is, no matter how we celebrate Holy Communion, whether it's with fresh bread or tortillas or crackers or a communion wafer, whether it's with water or wine or juice, the Lord is present, and the Lord comes inside of us once again to renew us, that we would feel forgiven of the things that didn't quite go right since you last had communion. Now, if you've never taken communion in this church, you are welcome at our table. I think back of the first time I took communion, and I hadn't been to Sunday school, and I hadn't gone through confirmation, and I really didn't know what it was all about. But I went up with open hands and an open mind and a heart that so needed to feel again. However you come today, whether it's coming with joy, or coming with sorrow, or coming with confusion, or doubt, come. Come and feel the risen Christ enter into you. You sit back down, take a deep breath. If you want to look up, if you want to look down, you want to cross your arms, however you want to feel like you're the only one here. Just take that little moment for yourself that you would sit with the Lord. Amen. The table is set. The table is ready. talking about how you offer yourself to others. How do you offer what you know is true to your friends and neighbors? Are you the example of how you should behave? Or are you the example of how you should not behave? I think we have a little bit of that in each of us, don't we? But people look at us, and they look to us to see if it's real, right? Is there really a change that comes about people when they know Jesus? When they put their faith and their trust in the Holy Spirit leading and guiding them? When they put their faith and trust in our Creator God, who loved us so much that He breathed His breath of life into us? Hoorah. Join our voices together and praise our God. Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Bradshaw Mountains.
The Bradshaw Mountains, up by Breezy Pines. The fire is just about 2 miles away from our community. So people have lost their homes in this, and we may have some work to do in helping them out.
I have a joy. My oldest daughter, Laura, in Phoenix, is going to soon have her children all home this next weekend to honor her as she graduates with her master's in counseling. And then the next day, they're going to Sholo, where her oldest son is finally getting married.
Graduating and celebrating here.
I'd like to have prayers for my family, my husband's family. His mom is failing rapidly. They figure she may only have about another month to live.
And what is her first name?
Shirley.
Shirley. Lord Almighty, we give you thanks and we praise you for the life of Shirley. And we ask that at the end of her life, you would send just the right people to put their arms around her, to put their heads together, and to pray and to think about what paradise will be like next. And will you please, God, surround the family with compassion and with kindness and with wonderful memories they'll never forget.
Thank you everybody for praying for my son and his eye. Monday when we went to the specialist, he did not have to have another shot. They're watching it. He is able to see out of that eye. That yellow film is gone. Continue to pray for him in Jesus' name that he will regain 100% of his eye in Jesus' name. Thank you.
What his first name is?
Martin.
Okay, Martin. Thank you. Commuters?
Yeah. Prayers for a friend's little grandbaby that was born about a week ago. He was born a 6-month period of the mother's pregnancy, and he doesn't have a foot. He's missing a foot. He's able to breathe on his own, but he's now developing infection, and he's in the hospital, just struggling. There are prayers for the baby and for the parents.
And what did they name him? It's okay.
Can't remember.
Lord, you know this child, and you know the stress that the parents are under, and the sorrow that they're feeling even through the birth of life. Would you bind them together, Lord, that they would become a true family, that they would thrive in each other's presence, and that, Lord, you would be present with them always. Okay. Our closing hymn is in the green book also, 3180. And it's As We Part From the Towns and Cities. Is this a familiar hymn? Winnell, can you just play one verse for us so they can get a feel of it? Remember each other throughout the week. May the prayers come to heart and mind, and may we share the love of Christ and an invitation to our friends and neighbors to come. Come worship with us. Come meet our wonderful congregation. And if you're listening online, you are welcome here anytime. We would love to meet you face to face. God's blessing.